Well, good morning, everyone. And again, thanks so much for joining us. I've already mentioned this, but we are decided to go ahead and redo our worship service this this morning because of some of the technical issues that that we were having all throughout last night. And unfortunately, it was kind of a wild time, but we got over that. You know, I was just thinking, again, when you think about these past couple of years, not only with COVID, when you think about the weather we've had the past couple of weekends, and then of course the technical issues last night, man, it just can seem that life is a little bit out of control. And yet here's the great thing. When life seems out of control, God is in control. And that is, again, a wonderful thing for us to be able to be reassured of. And so let's start this time with a word of prayer, and then we're going to worship the Lord, focus in on him. And so let's pray. God, thank you. Thank you that you are in control of all things. And because of that, we can trust you. We can trust you when life doesn't go the way that we want it to go. We can trust you when challenges and problems arise, because God, you are good and you are sovereign and you love us. And so God, thanks that in the midst of all of the things that seem out of control, we can trust that you are in control. And because of that, Lord, we can have peace in you. And so would you continue to cause our faith to rise up, and to believe that you are who you say you are, and you always do what you say that you would do. And so lead us now as we focus on you and worship you. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Want to know how to make life go easier? Trust in Jesus. Thank you. Because he will do it again. What he's done before, he will do again. He never leaves us out in those troubles. He brings us through those troubles, and he walks through them with us. And we can trust him. Yeah, there's troubles. Don't do it alone, because we need to give him room to do it again.
I'm still in your hands, and this
Sometimes just hang on. Oh, wishing that things were different, wishing things would change, wishing things would go back to those good old days. And Father, I know that those good old days were where we met you, but that's not where you were taking us, not where you were going to keep us, not how you were going to grow us. Even as we spoke this morning of purification of gold, how we work through with endurance and the heat of that fire causes the dross to rise so that the gold becomes pure. And Father, as you draw the dross off, you are drawing us close, growing us into the image of your Son, filling us full with your Holy Spirit. Undeserved privilege. Forgive us, Father, that we forget. Forgive us that we forget that we stand in a place of undeserved privilege, and that somehow, some way, some days, we take it for granted. Father, forgive us for that. Your love, your sacrifice, your Son, your Spirit, your will and your way will never be just everyday occurrences. Open our eyes to see all that you are and help us to trust you more. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated.
You know, as Jim shared, I think many of us can relate of longing to be back in pre-pandemic days when we were able to be together and not worry about COVID and everything else that was going on. And, you know, at the same time, it's great to know that, again, God is sovereign, that he's in control. And as a result, we can not only trust him, but we can have peace. You know, last night I woke up in the middle of the night and I was having a difficult time sleeping. And so I got up, I opened up the word, and this is what I read. My psalm for the day was Psalm 4. And at the end of Psalm 4, it says, "In peace, I will both lie down and sleep, for you alone, O Lord, may we dwell in safety." Isn't that a great verse? We can have peace because God is in control. And because of that, we can know that he will take care of us. He will watch over us. What a great reassurance that is. Well, let me just remind you of a few things here. Let me make a couple adjustments here technologically here. Hold on for just a second. Sorry, hopefully that will get your picture up a little bit better here. But let me just share just a few reminders here. So coming up next Friday, we are going to have our evening of worship and prayer. And so we will be meeting together at Liberty down at their lower level. And we'll have that opportunity to come together to pray together. So highly encourage you to join us for that time. It's always a good time to pray as well as worship the Lord. And then if you're so led, feel free to bring a dessert appetizer to share afterwards. But again, always a great time to come together. So that's going to be this coming Friday at 7 p.m. And then let me say thank you to all of you that continue to faithfully give and support Hope. We so appreciate that. A little bit later on, whether it be this month or maybe next month, we'll be coming together for a short congregational meeting, and Brian's going to give us just a recap of last year. But again, just wanted to say thank you so much for you continuing to give to the Lord, supporting Hope, but also obviously supporting the kingdom as you do. And so just wanted to say thank you for that. As way of reminder, there's a number of ways that you can give. Obviously, if you are in person, and hopefully we will be in person again next Saturday evening, you place that in the offering box. Otherwise, you can mail that, or you can talk to Brian about electronic giving, and his number is there, and you can contact him there if you would like more information. All right, well, let's pray together here. Jesus, thanks again that we can have peace because you are in control, and as a result, you not only can have peace, but we can sleep well, knowing that you are taking care of us, that you are protecting us, providing for us, and leading and guiding us. And for that, Jesus, again, we are so, so grateful. And so, Lord, thanks for the way that you continue to give to us, and we give to these our tithes and our offering to you as, again, just a token of our appreciation for all that you've done for us. And so thank you, Lord. Now, Lord, I pray that you would continue to speak to us as we continue our service today. We ask that in your name, Jesus. Amen. Well, last fall, there was a video that really spoke to me in some powerful ways. In fact, I would say that it was probably the message that I appreciated the most throughout last year. It's a message that my daughter, Hannah, who was on staff with Crew, sent Ali and myself. And the speaker is actually a professor, an English professor at Penn State. Now, that's not the reason why I am showing this this video, although obviously you know I'm a Penn State fan. But she is a full-time faculty member and an English professor there. But her husband is on staff with CRU. In fact, he leads the graduate ministry and I think is tied in also with the faculty ministry there. And so he's full-time and staff with CRU. She's an associate staff member and had a very powerful, powerful message. And I thought that it would not only encourage you personally in terms of who you are in Christ, but also challenge you as we talk about what the repercussions of our identity in Christ. And so sit back, listen to this message. By the way, there is a little bit of a 1 minute. They also had a little bit of a video audio glitch in there, but it's just lasts for about 1 minute. And so just be patient. It'll take me a second here to boot this up. And so if you just sit back and hopefully we'll get this going.
First of all, I just have to say, when people introduce me like that, you know, with a viral cat post and that I have like vivid verbs, I know that every one of you are like, why did we invite her to come? It's not cool. But yes, I do. I posted a picture of my cat in wrapping paper and Twitter posted it to their Twitter moments. And I'm like a celebrity now on Twitter. It happened. My viral moment. But it's true, I'm the type of girl who reads grammar books for fun, and I am obsessed with vivid verbs. But you need to know that because the Lord used a single verb in scripture to change everything about me. And the reason why I love that is because the Lord drew me to him in the very way that would matter most to my heart, because that's who he is. I want you to think about Psalm 33. It says that God formed the hearts of all and considers everything they do. He formed the hearts of all and he considers everything they do. So he knows you're here right now. And I love it. Now I know some of you are here and you're maybe seeking the Lord for the first time. And I wanted to share with you, there's this moment in scripture, sometimes when I speak, I always share this, and it was the wise words that David wanted to give to his son before his son launched out kind of into his adult role. It's David's final words to his son Solomon, and this is what he says in 1 Chronicles 28. The Lord searches every heart and understands every desire and every thought. If you seek him, he will be found by you. If you seek him, he will be found by you. Tonight I want to share with you a way I was seeking the Lord and a moment that I found him. It was a moment in scripture that was so powerful that the people who knew me best in my life said to me, Heather, what has happened to you? You have become a different person. It was a summer day in late July, and I encountered a passage that I will share with you, but first I want to tell you what I was like before I experienced this moment in scripture. I was nearing 40 years old. I know, a lot older than a lot of you in this room, but I think some of you can relate. I was becoming increasingly obsessed with myself, self-involved, always thinking about myself. I was jealous. As time was going on, I just became that person who would, I was so jealous of everyone else's amazing life. This is a true story. I was crying in the church bathroom one spring break because a family came up to me to tell me about their glamorous tropical vacation, and they had matching new outfits for all of their children. And I was so jealous. I cried in the church bathroom. I was like, where's my tropical vacation? Where are my popular, well-dressed children? I mean, it was getting so bad. I was deeply sad. I was getting, the older I got, the sadder I got. I thought to myself, surely there is a life happening somewhere. I just need to find where that life is. I need to find where life is. I was like what the psychologist Lauren Slater says. She says it like this: I ache for something I cannot name. I needed something I needed Jesus, and I didn't know what was wrong with me. I didn't know how to find him, but I thought to myself, I want to be the kind of person where knowing Jesus and being with him is better than any life I could design or imagine for myself. Can you imagine if that were true when you left this conference, that Jesus was the best thing? You knew he was the best thing that could ever happen to you, and that knowing him and being with him is better than any life you could design or imagine for yourself. So there's a quote I share with my writing students at Penn State. It's by the Argentine writer Jorge Luis Borges, and he says this: every destiny, however long and complicated, essentially boils down to a single moment, a moment when a man knows once and for all who he is. And this was my moment. It was a summer day in late July, and I turned to a passage of scripture that I had maybe read 1,000 times before. But on this day, the Holy Spirit made his powerful word come alive to me. I'm gonna read you a longer portion of it, and then you'll see part of it on the screen, but it's Ephesians 2, and it's the Apostle Paul. He's writing to the church in Ephesus to kind of explain to these new believers, this is everything you need to know about the gospel. This is the most important thing you need to know about Jesus. If you're here and you're seeking Christ for the first time, this is a beautiful description of the gospel, and this is what Paul says. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath. That's how I felt most of my life. Before I knew Christ, I felt that. I was dead inside. And then it says this: but because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ. This is the verse I want you to look at. God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you've been saved through faith. This is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. I'm looking at Ephesians 2:6, and I see that little verb, seated. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus. Now, as an advanced grammar professor, someone who's obsessed with vivid verbs, and yes, semicolons, I couldn't get over a couple things. First of all, I couldn't get over that it was a past tense verb. Even in the Greek, it's this sense that something has already been declared about you, that there's something that's true about you right now in the spiritual realm that Paul understood. He was writing most likely from a Roman prison, and yet he saw himself as seated with Christ in the heavenly realms. That was confusing. The second thing I thought of, I'm looking at that verb and I'm like, God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him. My question was, why is Jesus seated? By the way, you're getting insight into how I read my Bible. I'm always like, what? What does this verb mean? Why? What? Why is Jesus seated? And then my heart exploded in worship because I asked the question, why is Jesus seated? And I remembered something that I had read in Hebrews 10 many years earlier, and it says this: day after day, every priest stands and performs his religious duties. Again and again, he offers the same sacrifices which can never take away sin. But when this priest, Jesus, had offered for all time one sacrifice for sin, he sat down at the right hand of God. For by one sacrifice, he has made perfect forever those who are being made holy. I started to like well up in worship inside of my heart. I was like, Jesus, you're seated in the heavenly realms and you invite me to take a seat with you there. I said, Lord, please teach me what this means because I think it has something to do with this ache I cannot name. Sometimes when I'm confused and I can't quite get a passage of scripture, I'll ask myself what the great British preacher Charles Spurgeon said about it. And I looked up a sermon that he had written on this concept of Hebrews 10, and he says this: every priest stood because there was work to do. Still, they must present their sacrifices, but our Lord sits down because there was no more sacrificial work to do. Atonement is complete. There were no seats in the tabernacle. Observe the Levitical descriptions and you will see that there were no resting places for priests in the holy place. A priest never sat. And the readers of Ephesians would have known that. Jesus sits in the Holy of Holies, and we see that his work is finished. So I'm sitting there, and I'm like, Jesus, you're seated. You're the one, and you invite me to take this seat with you. I saw myself there. I was like, here I am at the greatest table with the greatest king, and the way I get a seat is that free gift. I was dead in my transgressions and sin. God, who is rich in mercy, makes me alive in Christ. I just got so excited. It's like I understood my salvation again. But in July, when God showed me this verb, a lightning bolt of realization came to me that I do not live as if I'm seated at the greatest table with the greatest king. I live as if I'm fighting for a seat at the table. Everything about my life was fighting for a seat at the table. Now, at the time, I was like, if only I could sit at the table with the skinny women. I was in Weight Watchers, and I still am. I was like, if only I could get just a little bit thinner, life will really begin for me. Thank you for the people laughing over there. I was like, I would walk into rooms, and I'd be like, if only I could sit with the women who run marathons. It is never going to happen for me. There were so many tables. I was like, if only I had more money. You know, I have a 14-year-old. Now it's like, one day I could be TikTok famous. There is a place where you think, if only I could get an invitation to that table, life would really begin for me. Well, I was sitting there with Jesus, and it was as if the Holy Spirit said to me, you can stop fighting so hard. The seat you've been longing for all your life is here. Now start living like a seated person. Now that became very important for me that year because my oldest daughter was starting middle school. And she gives permission to share this story, but I always like to ask, how many of you remember middle school as the best years of your life? Two people. Oh, you were popular. No. You were popular. I know. Sarah comes home. My daughter is changing before my eyes. She's starting sixth grade. Her stomach hurts. She doesn't want to go to school. And I'm upstairs in my office, and I'm working on this idea that I'm seated with Christ, and I'm studying Ephesians 2. Like, God, thank you. I'm seated with you at the greatest table with the greatest king. And Sarah comes up to my office, and she says this, Mom, I can't find a place to sit in the lunchroom. And I said, honey, what's going on? Her best friends from kindergarten all the way up have decided she is not cool enough. She's too socially awkward. She does not get to sit at their table in the lunchroom. How many of you all remember that? The wound is deep. Thank you. I always tell her, I'm like, look, Sarah, you're not the only one. Everyone, there's that seat in middle school. And I said to her, Sarah, I know, I said, you know, she was 12 years old, so I could still pull her up in my lap. I said, look, come on up on my lap. I'm going to read to you a passage of scripture. You got to imagine it. It's a spiritual reality. I said, it's going to be hard. And I read to her Ephesians 2. And I said, look, Sarah, you are seated with Christ. I don't want you to think about those popular girls anymore. Jesus chose you for his table. You're at the best table. I said, I want you to walk into that lunchroom and I want you to say, I'm seated with Christ in the heavenly realms. And then you can look around for maybe other girls that don't have a place and you can invite them. And I could see the Holy Spirit applying the scripture to her heart because I could see her face light up and she's like, Mom, I see it, I do. Thankfully, we were watching the BBC's rendition of King Arthur and the Knights of the Round Table, Merlin, anyone? Best show. Best show. You know, we're looking at images of King Arthur calling the knights to the round table. And I said, Sarah, I don't know what we're supposed to see, but it's kind of like we're a knight at the round table with Jesus. And it's a round table. Do you guys remember why it's a round table? Anyone? Tell us. Everyone, no one's more important than anyone else. It's a round table. Nobody's superior. Nobody's inferior. They're all devoted to the king. I said to Sarah, look, we're like knights at the round table. Now, it got so deep in this child, and she knew she was seated so deeply that for her senior pictures, she's wearing the necklace that says seated. This girl grew so powerful into a leader in her high school. She was the one that I would walk into like PTO meetings. I'd be all nervous because there'd be the women over there selling essential oyils. I'm never gonna fit in. There'd be like, you know, there'd be like these moms. And I'd be like, Sarah, I don't have any place to sit. And Sarah would be like, Mom, # seated. She would be the one. But we all have this wound of places we never sat. Places we never sat. Some of you in this room, there's a wound of places you will never sit. Places you've sat that you're no longer going to sit at for whatever reason. This idea that I was seated with Christ became so powerful as I began looking at all of those tables I thought would finally bring me life. 1 year during our crew training, I actually heard Johnny Erickson Tata. She's in a wheelchair for her life. If you don't know the story, she was in a diving accident, paralyzed, never going to use her body, never going to get out of that wheelchair. And I heard her say, I would rather be seated in my wheelchair knowing Jesus than be given the chance to walk without him. And I just thought, what does this woman know? So picture this table. You know, as I became really obsessed with this image of me being seated at the greatest table with the greatest king, it slowly began to change everything about me. I thought, God, is this weird that I'm obsessing over this image in scripture? No, Paul reiterates this in Colossians 3. Since then, you've been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died. And your life is now hidden with Christ in God. So you're seated people. You can live in that reality. But as I sat there with my journal and as I began to study, what does this mean in Ephesians 2 that I'm seated with you in the heavenly realms? I began to ask myself, what is keeping me from that reality? And I learned this. It was true then and it's true now. There are three things that will dominate your adult life if you forget to see that you are seated with Christ in the heavenly realms. And those three things, this is true in the history of therapeutic literature, and it's true in my life today. This is what it feels like to live like you're fighting for a seat at the table. You will be dominated by what therapists call the three A's: appearance, affluence, and achievement. You might have a different set of words. I like A's because I'm going to show you some verbs to replace them from scripture. But you may have some other tables. But for me, I believe life will begin if I can just get my appearance right, if I'm just beautiful. Affluence is the pursuit of wealth. I believe I have a seat if I'm with the affluent. Achievement. You will believe that life is meaningful and abundant if only you are achieving. Now, I had all three of those problems. I was living in fear, jealousy, and despair. At the University of Virginia, where I went to my undergrad, I was crying on my dorm room floor, praying that my roommate Sarah wouldn't come in, because I was exhausting myself, exercising, hardly eating at all, trying to be thinner, exhausting myself, trying to think of money I would make. You know, what was my job going to be? So nervous about the future. I was someone that was just overly exhausting myself, trying to achieve freshman year. And I'm crying on my dorm room floor because I had just read John 10:10, where Jesus says, "I have come that you may have life and have it abundantly." I'm crying and I said, "Jesus, come into my life, make me the type of woman I'm supposed to be." From that moment on, though, I had been dominated still by the appearance, affluence, and achievement. And it wasn't till that summer day in late July when I realized I don't have to live like I'm fighting for a seat at those tables. So I'm going to give you some different verbs to replace those three words. And maybe God will set you free the way he set me free. So seated people don't worry about their appearance. Seated people don't worry about their appearance, and I may test you later, because they adore. Seated people adore. I was obsessed with my appearance, worried all the time about my face, my body, my hair. And I began to look at some really powerful passages. One is Psalm 34:5. Those who look to him are radiant. Their faces are never covered with shame. When you're seated with Christ, you're just adoring the King, and you radiate the beauty of Christ wherever you go. I actually had a pastor's wife come up to me one day, and she goes, "Heather, I just want you to know you have a very loving face." I was like, "Loving? Are you sure you didn't mean, you know, beautiful?" But it was actually one of the best compliments I've ever received in my life. You know, I think about Psalm 27:4. David says, "One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life and gaze on the beauty of the Lord and seek him in his temple." I thought about adoring Jesus and how seated people, they're so secure, they just adore him. I began to actually walk into a room and think to myself, okay, look, I'm just radiating the beauty of Christ. This is it. And praise God for that, because you guys, this is the best I can do. You know, this is as good as it's gonna get. I teach my college students, though. There's a research article that came out in Perception magazine in 2000. Now, I had a moment with the Lord, because I'm old enough. I was like, "God, what are you doing? Because by the time, you know, I'm turning 45 years old, there's another quote I keep in my purse. Not everything you put in your prayer journal will he answer. I kept this from missionary Elizabeth Elliot. She said this, because, you know, there are things that I thought, "God, you've withheld this from me." Oh, no, listen to this. This is a woman who has suffered greatly, and she said, "God never withholds from his child that which his love and wisdom call good. God's refusals are always merciful. Severe mercies at times, but mercies all the same. God never denies us our heart's desire except to give us something better." And I just got so excited as I, you know, looked at my life. But I'll be honest with you. Remember the jealousy that I had? You know, I'm in a community with a lot of wealthy people. You know, my husband and I are on staff. We raise support. When I was growing up in college, especially at the University of Virginia, and then going to University of Michigan for my PhD, you know, I was fantasizing about my life of wealth, my life of fame and wealth. I really was. You know, and I like wealth. I like people that have a lot of money. I like to hang out with them. I like them to take me to dinner. You know, I like being around wealthy people. The jealousy issue was bad. You know, I'm seeing all these other people, you know, accumulate more houses, more vacations, whatever. And I was like, God, help me see that I'm seated with you and I have all that, I have everything I need. I have access to all the riches of God's kingdom. Well, I found a quote in a random library book one day when I was really struggling with jealousy. And this is the quote. It comes from the Hayden Planetarium in New York. It comes from the museum guide, and this is all it says. All seats provide equal viewing of the universe. And I started getting tears in my eyes, and I said, I don't know what's happening. And I called the Hayden Planetarium because I do things like that. And I said, can you tell me, what is this quote? All seats provide equal viewing of the universe. And the media director of the Hayden Planetarium explained to me that when the children come on a field trip, they race into the planetarium. They all run to the front row in an arena where there are no best seats. So the museum guide has to say, children, all seats provide equal viewing of the universe. No matter where you sit, you won't miss any part of the show. And I'm like, that's so beautiful. No matter where you sit, you won't miss any part of the show. I'm driving in my neighborhood in a used minivan, and the bumper is attached with electrical tape. I am in a thrift store wardrobe, and I'm like, all seats provide equal viewing of the universe. I was like, God, all seats provide equal access to your love, your provision, your joy. It doesn't matter where I am, what seat you put me in the physical realm, I have access to all of you all the time. God began to set me free because of that little quote. Now, I love A.W. Tozer. He's a good Pennsylvania theologian. And as I was thinking about this seat in the heavenly realms and that for the rest of my life, I would just access the riches of the Lord, I found this quote that I love. It's a little deep, but I love it. It says this: God is so vastly wonderful, so utterly and completely delightful, that he can, without anything other than himself, meet and overflow the deepest demands of our total nature, mysterious and deep as that nature is. Now, I'm a deep woman. I'm complex inside. You know, I hold office hours. Students come in, they're like, I'm so deep, I'm so complex, nobody gets me. You know, the Lord knows the complexity of your heart. He's able to meet that, and it's so beautiful. So by the time I got to this A, you know, that seated people don't worry about affluence because they know they have access, I'm starting to realize that there's no problem I have in my life that can't actually be solved by my understanding my seat in the heavenly realms with Jesus. It became such a deep, transformative moment. Here I am seated with Christ. It's this conscious union with him by faith at this table, my seat that I've always longed for, this seat I've always longed for. But there was this last one that God needed to deal with in me, and it's the final A. Do you want me to do a quick review? Seated people don't worry about their appearance because they, oh good. It's like my class. Seated people don't worry about affluence because they know they have
access.
So good. Seated people don't worry about achievement. Now, this verb that I'm going to give you, seated people abide. They abide. Now, why does this matter? At the end of Ephesians 2, It says that we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. That means you don't need to worry about anything. You abide with him. Your life is inevitably going to bear the fruit that he has designed for you. I became so excited as I was like, God, why have I been jealous of the pastor's wife, my sister, these girls over here doing this, these guys doing this, this achievement here, this achievement there? That's the good works you prepared for them. Those aren't my good works. I've got good works you prepared for me. I stay up late at night thinking of Philippians 2:13. It's a really weird verse, even in the Greek. It says this, "For it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill his good purpose." In other words, God is working within you to give you the desire and the ability to do what he wants you to do with your life. I thought, Lord, this is powerful. I don't need to worry. And you know, I'm in an academic setting. It's all about high achievement. You know, I'm an author. Everything's about sales and comparison. You know, praise God, I finally have a viral tweet. That's going to mean something. The cat. You know, I'm like, what? I'm going to die if I keep measuring myself. We all will. I'm never going to be TikTok famous. You know that. I do have a TikTok. But it really sets me free to think, you know, John 15, you're going to abide in him and bear fruit. Jesus says so clearly, I chose you and appointed you that you would bear fruit. Tomorrow, I'm going to talk a little bit about what that fruit is. Remain in me, you will bear much fruit. You know, a seated life, you're set apart for good works prepared, and the Holy Spirit's giving you the ability and the desire to do what he wants you to do, and you don't need to compare your fruit to anyone. You don't. You don't need to compare the timing of it. You don't need to compare your life to anyone. You're seated with him. You're a knight at the round table. You're devoted to him. You're in a place of royalty, relaxation. It's powerful. As I thought, though, of this new identity I had that people were noticing, a really strange moment happened, and the moment was this. I was rejoicing in my seat in the heavenly realms, and then I decided to ask this question. Who is not yet at the table with me? And that's when I realized that when you're seated, God secures you in that place and then sends you on a rescue mission for people. I couldn't get over this idea that inviting others to take their seat at the greatest table with the greatest king it's the greatest rescue mission the world will ever know. And I answered a call that day to this rescue mission, and there was another A word that God gave me. Seated people, they adore, they access, they abide, but they're available. They make themselves available for God to use them to be a spokesperson. I cannot wait to share with you what God's been teaching me when we share in the morning about this idea that you're seated and now sent. So I said to the Lord, okay, I'm going to be available. I'm going to be available, and I'm going to love my neighbors. Why? I was looking at the scriptures where it says in Acts 17 that God searches out the exact places where I live. And I was looking at passages where Jesus says, like in 2 Corinthians, that I'm an ambassador and that God will make his appeal through me. I just couldn't get over this idea when Jesus says, follow me and I will send you out to fish for people. So I was praying and I thought, God, seated people make themselves available to the people around them that don't yet know Jesus. So I was sitting in my house, it was a Tuesday morning, and I was like, God, this is real. I'm gonna be available to you. I'm gonna cancel everything. I don't need to spend all my time at church. I need to hang out where the unbelievers are, and they're all in my neighborhood. I'm gonna love these neighbors. So I canceled everything. I wasn't teaching class that day. I didn't go to campus. I sat on my couch. I decided to drink a cup of coffee with hazelnut creamer. And my husband was like, what are you doing? And I was like, I am under specific instructions to be available to the Lord. He was like, okay. But I was. I sat there in my house and I prayed. And I was like, God, I know I'm seated with you. I want to be available for you to use me in the lives of people. 9 o'clock goes on. 10 o'clock. I was like, I'm crazy, but I'm going to sit here and I'm going to keep praying. All of a sudden, just as I'm about to abandon my crazy commitment to availability to people, I hear a minivan in my driveway, and a neighbor who lives down the street, who I hardly know, gets out of her minivan, and she's balancing two cups of coffee. And she comes up to my house and rings the doorbell. I open it. I say, hello. She says, hey, you know, I'm down the street. I just got my hair cut and I really wanted to show someone. Are you available? I was like, I got nothing to do. Come on in. Come on in. Because I knew that the Lord had sent her, I felt really excited. I just went right there. We talked about the Lord. I prayed for her children. She began a spiritual journey where she ended up praying to receive Christ, and she's the type of woman who... She's the type of woman who 3 weeks ago, she called me and she was like, Heather, you know that other friend we have? It's time for you to go tell her about Jesus. You're available. But I wanted to end with this last story about the rescue mission, because it's a story that I don't like to tell because it's kind of mystical, and I'm sort of an academic person, but this is a true story that happened to me, and it really revealed to me the heart of God, and it kind of changed everything about me. So I want to end with this story. I was rejoicing with the Lord that I was seated with Christ. He had changed me. He had changed me. I was set free for the first time in my life to just be the woman God had called me to be. And I was in my house just praying for my neighbors one day. And I was like, God, thank you that I'm seated, and thank you that you are just going to send me out. I'm available. And I got this really weird feeling inside that felt like the Holy Spirit. But again, I'm an academic. I like listening to God through scripture. I tend to be really skeptical of people that claim that they, you know, hear audible things from God. Well, I just felt this sense inside, like, go leave the house. Go leave the house in the minivan. I had an appointment at noon, and it was like 11. I was like, well, that's an hour early. What am I going to do, drive around my neighborhood? I was like, Lord, is that you? So I was like, okay, this is weird. Okay, I'll leave my house. But it gets even weirder. I go into my closet because it was an autumn day, and I was like, oh, maybe I should wear that scarf. I was like, no, that scarf is really ugly. I hate that scarf. I was like, no, I should wear that scarf. I put the scarf on. It gets even weirder. I get in my car, and I was like, I think I really want to listen to Bruce Springsteen. I think I want to listen to Hungry Heart, which is not even his best song. I pull out of the driveway, and I'm like, Lord, I kind of feel crazy. No sooner do I pull out of my driveway and turn left on my street than I see that there is a professor standing on the corner, and she is weeping. I pull up my minivan, and I said, is everything okay? What's going on? She comes over and she goes, oh, you're wearing the scarf I got you for your birthday. Oh, you're listening to Bruce Springsteen. That's my favorite song. Can I get in? And I was like, what? My mouth is hanging open. So shocked am I. This woman says to me, what are you doing here? I thought you had appointments today. And I said, Deb, Jesus sent me to go get you. And she just started crying. And I started crying. I was like, Jesus sent me to go get you. And then I thought to myself, that's what he does. He sends us to go get people. Either you're the one that's sent, or you're the one crying on the corner. Either way, we got to all work together here. You know, it was almost like revival started in my neighborhood. I was like, God, clearly there is a rescue mission here. Clearly I'm seated and sent. I would just leave my house and I would talk to people as if they were already Christians. I would talk to them about Jesus. I would tell neighbors. I was like, I gotta gather people. Let's walk to school. Let's have neighborhood fitness parties. Now I'm doing a soup and story night on Monday night. I make soup. The neighbors come over. They say, what can I bring? And I say, nothing but a story. That's why I called it soup and story. Isn't it cute? Soup and story. But there was a woman, you know, this idea, like, what this supernatural life that I didn't think, you know, is this what God does when you're seated and sent? I just want to end with this final quote from a neighbor who said, we're walking to school, you know, she's someone who is in the Hindu tradition. I would just talk to her about what God was teaching me in the Bible. And I turned to her one day and I said, Joanne, does it bother you that I talk so much about Jesus? And she said, no, I need you to tell me everything you know about him. Not only did she pray to receive Christ, she led her husband and two children to the Lord. You are seated at the greatest table with the greatest king. I've basically solved all your problems. But tomorrow, I'm going to talk about this role that you're seated and sent for the rest of your life. And it is a beautiful way for you to begin 2020, totally set free from appearance, affluence, and achievement. You're now adoring, accessing, abiding for the rest of your life. Two words, you're seated, and tomorrow you're going to be sent. Let me pray over you. Lord, thank you so much for time to be in your powerful word. Thank you that you make your word come alive to us. Thank you that you are real, that this is real, that Jesus, you sat down at the right hand of God. You're our final atoning sacrifice for sin, and we worship you. Help us see ourselves as seated with you in the heavenly realms. Help us understand we don't need to live in jealousy and comparison anymore. We can live seated with you for the rest of our lives, and we're just so grateful. Thank you that you raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms. I pray for each person here that you would give them a spirit of revelation to know these things like never before. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Wasn't that a powerful message? You know, I shared last night to everyone, that is now my fifth or sixth time, I think, that I've listened to this message. And every time I tear up hearing those stories. And I guess that's not surprising because, one, the gospel never gets old, and it never gets old hearing about how people have come to know Christ. And so, so powerful. Let me encourage you not only to apply those principles this week that you are seated with Christ, but to join us next Saturday evening or Sunday morning for the replay. We're going to listen to Heather Holloman's second message about being sent. And again, it's very, very powerful. She's also going to give some very practical suggestions. So make sure that you join us next weekend. Well, let's wrap up our time. We're going to sing one last song together. Let me pray. Jesus, thanks again. Thanks for that message by Heather Holloman. And even more so, Lord, thanks for the promises of your word that you see us right now as seated with you, that that is our identity in you. Jesus, would you help us to really, truly live that out? Help us to not only believe you and trust you for that, but Jesus, I pray that you would help us to live in the reality of that truth, that we would live out that truth every day by the way that we look at you, by the way that we look at ourselves, by the way that we look at others. And so thanks. We love you, Lord. Thanks again for the incredible calling and the identity that you've given us in you. We ask you that in your name, Jesus. Amen. Well, again, thanks everyone for joining us. Go ahead and unmute your mic and you can turn your video on.